Hello, my name is Kate Milliken, and I want to welcome you all to Empowered By, which is our live webcast that we do at My Counterpain. The purpose of this webcast is to pull together people who are involved with the science and the research of living with of MS, as well as people who are actually living the problems of what we discuss. And I'm super excited for today's show, which is MS and clinical trials. And the reason why I feel especially excited about this is MS is the leading neurological condition that has had the most progress in terms of research. And there is a hotbed of things happening in relapsing remitting MS and progressive MS that are worth talking about. And we are going to do a deep dive into this research, talking specifically about clinical trials. So the bridge between an idea and a reality is the clinical trial. Three phases of testing efficacy and safety about these ideas that are actually helping with the issue of MS. So let me introduce the two people that we have on right now. With us in the blue shirt is Dr. Bruce Bebo, who is the Executive Vice President of Research for the National MS Society. There is a chance that of all the people on the planet, Bruce Bebo may know the most about every clinical trial happening in the world. He's got his hand on the pulse, and I'm really excited to hear what he knows and to give us some insights into clinical trials. Also with us is a dear friend and my counterpain user named Mitch Sturgeon. Mitch has been with us since inception, and if anyone wants to know more about Mitch and his sensational story, I highly recommend you go onto My Counterpain and you search Mitch Sturgeon. He's got it all laid out from the beginning. He's phenomenal for a gajillion reasons. One, not only being an active participant in My Counterpain, but also, in fact, he has an incredible blog called enjoyingtheride.com. Absolutely worth following. So I welcome both of you guys. I'm really excited to have this conversation. And I feel, Bruce, that maybe we start with you just to kind of set the stage on what a clinical trial is. So why don't you give us an overview?
Sure, Kate. Thanks. It's great to be on with you and everyone. So a clinical trial is it's a study. It's carefully designed, and it's designed to test the benefits and the risks of a specific treatment. Or an intervention. It doesn't have to be a drug. It could also be a behavioral change like a diet or a rehabilitation strategy. And every clinical trial has a lead investigator that's often called a principal investigator or in the kind of science speak, a PI. And it's usually a doctor, a medical doctor. And there's also a team of researchers and doctors and nurses and others. And the FDA requires a multi-phased approach to clinical trials, a sort of stepwise approach, and in order to determine whether a medicine or an intervention is safe and effective, and to understand, you know, its effectiveness and safety.
One of the things that I remember being the most struck by as I started learning about clinical trials are the scope and the cost. And certainly amongst our viewers and online, and I know you know this, there is a constant conversation about the cost of drugs. And I think it's important for you to talk a little bit about the cost of clinical trials and how those relate.
Sure. So let's talk about the different phases, Kate, and then we'll talk about what they all cost at the end to do. So there are three, and I think many people are aware of this, but there are three sort of phases of clinical development. And then let's also, even before we jump into that, explain that there's a ton of time and resources and energy that go into developing candidate targets for drugs or interventions before they even get to a clinical trial. There's a lot of resources that go into identifying potential agents or strategies for any particular disease or disorder, including MS. So that all happens before we get into clinical studies. If we're going to talk about clinical trials, again, there are three sort of phases. And so phase one, probably people have heard about that phase one trial. This is testing a drug on healthy volunteers. So this is not people living with whatever the disorder or disease is. These are healthy people. It is the goal of this is to determine whether a drug is safe. And it's often looking at the relationship between the dose that's given and the amount of the agent that's in the blood or in the body. So we're getting a sense for what the dosing is, getting a sense for how safe it is. And that's the purpose of phase one. It's just, they're small. They're usually maybe 10, 20, 30, maybe as many as 100, depends. But those, they're small, just to look at safety.
And people, then, and people that are in them don't necessarily have MS.
They don't. And in fact, they want people who don't have MS and that are otherwise healthy to-
As kind of a control.
Exactly, as a control. So in phase two is the first time you're testing an agent or again, an intervention on the population that's living with the disorder or disease, right? So this, for example, an MS. This would be the first time a person with MS would be exposed to this drug. The idea of a phase two really is to inform the sponsor, the company or the university, of whether there's a hint or any effectiveness of the agent at all, right? So this is really where a lot in clinical trials, this is sort of the, they call kind of a go or no-go decision that for, again, for the sponsor to determine whether they want to make that investment in a large phase three trial. So in MS, for example, in relapsing MS, the outcome in a phase two trial is this enhancing lesion number or load or volume or amount of enhancing lesion. So if a drug for relapsing MS shows a really positive ability to reduce the number of these enhancing, you may have heard of this gadolinium enhancing or GAD or just enhancing lesions on an MRI, then that's a pretty good predictor of whether a drug or intervention is going to work in a phase three trial and whether it's going to work at all. And it's really actually interesting to point out here, Kate, that that's a really good sort of outcome measure at this phase two stage, or sometimes people call this proof of concept stage for relapsing MS. What we don't have and what we're working towards finding is an outcome measure like this at this phase of clinical development for progressive MS. We don't have that yet. And that's a challenge. That's a side note. But so these are, this is to test whether the drug looks like it has promised, you know, could potentially work. It's usually done in a few hundred, sometimes like 100, 150, maybe as many as 200 or 300 people to get a sense of whether it's working or not. It's all, we're also looking at safety at that stage, and in some cases you're even playing around with the dose to get a sense for what the dose might be.
And then phase three.
Yeah, and then comes the big one. So phase three, this is the phase that determines whether a drug may get approved or not. And these are large studies. They're oftentimes over 1,000 people. Some can approach a couple thousand people. The FDA requires two of these phase three studies for safety. So you oftentimes see the companies doing them in parallel, like two studies at the same time. That's the reason the FDA needs two, at least a year's worth of safety data, sometimes 2 years, and at least two separate studies of that magnitude in order to be able to have the data it needs to determine whether the drug is safe enough to allow it to be marketed. So this is the pivotal study. This is determining whether it's effective, determining whether it's safe, and this is the one that I mean, these all cost a lot of money, but this is the one that really pushes things over the top. So
give a ballpark, Bruce. Let's pretend, and obviously every case is individual, but yeah. I don't think people realize whether it's hundreds and thousands of dollars or millions or hundreds of millions of dollars.
Yeah, so when you put it all together, from discovery of a target through all the way through phase three and getting a drug into, you know, to market, it takes about, on average, 10 years. It costs about $2.6 billion, that's billion with a B, like
big
boy,
B, billion, big B.
On average, $2.6 billion. And then I think the other thing to keep in mind is that that less than 12% of the candidate medications or interventions that get to the first phase one, okay? These aren't all the things that failed all the way up to the clinical trial, but everything that, when you count all the drugs like in the whole environment, the whole universe that get to phase one, less than 12% make it to the market. And so you're also paying for all those failures. in addition to the costs of the clinical trials that, you know, for the agent that made it.
Wow. So obviously great ideas in science are hugely important in terms of furthering research, but so are people to test these great ideas on. And Mitch, this is where I'd love to bring you in. You have been part of a clinical trial a while back, and I'd love to hear a little bit about your experience.
Sure. First, Kate, thanks for inviting me on the show. You guys are doing wonderful things at My Counterpain. I'm glad to be part of it. So a little background. I was diagnosed in 2001 with primary progressive MS. I tried a couple of drugs that were approved for other forms of MS like Navantrone and Copaxone. I also tried oral methotrexate and something called low-dose naltrexone, and nothing seemed to help at all. And then my neurologist found what was called the Olympus trial. It was a rare trial for primary progressive MS, and it was a drug called Rituxan. So that started in about May of 2005. I had been going without treatment for about a year. So for me to join, it was kind of a no-brainer. And as Bruce mentioned, I knew that this company was investing a lot of money in a trial. So that gave me some confidence that they thought that, you know,
there was
a chance of working. Mm-hmm. So what I got was two infusions at a time, well, 2 weeks apart. And then I would wait 6 months and repeat it. And I did that for 2 years, a total of 8 infusions. I had to drive two hours each way to the trial. 2 or 3 times a month I did this. But I was glad to do it. It was exciting for me to be in a trial. And, you know, it was worth that commitment.
At that point, Mitch, how hard was it for you to actually find the trial?
Yeah, finding the trial was, I kind of stumbled onto it. I relied on my neurologist. I didn't have, I didn't know about some of the resources that are out there now. So it was kind of a situation where I relied on my neurologist, and luckily he found this trial. But I know there are better methods out there now, and we should probably talk about them. One thing about this trial was I knew that I was going to, there was a 33% chance that I would be on the placebo and a 67% chance I would be on the trial drug. But of course, I wouldn't know, and that's the whole purpose behind placebo-controlled trials. But I was still willing to go in and give that a try, not knowing. And then for me, the progression stopped for the first year on this trial, which was remarkable. Nothing had, all those other things I had tried had met with no success. And then in the second year of the trial, I found that maybe my progression started up a little bit again, but not very much. So that part of the trial was a big success for me, and well worth it for me.
So we'll do a little bit of a deeper dive a little later about how that experience ended for you. But for now, have you thought about pursuing another trial, and why not, if no?
Yeah, I'm always on the outlook for trials, but again, there aren't many for that. There weren't many for primary progressive. There's certainly a lot more now. But the other thing is most, at least drug trials, put an upper limit on the amount of disability that the participants can have. And I get that. There's a common measure called EDSS that probably most of the watchers are aware of. And people often, trial designers often put about a 6.5 limit on participants, and I'm now up around an 8. So I don't qualify for a lot of those trials. But I'm always on the outlook for opportunities, and I've actually done a lot of off-label kind of trials of one kind of thing because I've got to do something, and there's not always been a good clinical trial out there waiting for me.
Bruce, talk to me. I mean, we've kind of alluded to the world of progressive MS and clinical trials. So from your perspective, what are you seeing out there in terms of the amount of clinical trials?
Well, I think there are more clinical trials now in all forms of MS, and particularly progressive MS, than there ever have been before. I mean, so there's incredible momentum. I think we can talk perhaps about recent clinical trials that have shown agents that have effectiveness in progressive MS for the first time ever. There's a lot of excitement in the scientific community to pursue and focus on progressive MS as a real achievable goal now that I think is a real sort of ground change shift in the field for sure.
And one thing I want to mention that I know we spoke about before is the difference in a clinical trial between relapsing, remitting, and progressive in terms of using a placebo. Can you explain that?
Sure. Yeah. So Mitch mentioned that he was in a placebo-controlled trial, and that it was weighted 2/3 on the agent and 1/3 on a placebo, and that's the gold standard, right, for clinical trials. It's randomization. So this is taking when you register or put in the pool of people to participate in a trial, that you're selected randomly to go into one, the placebo group or the treatment group. And that really is necessary. This is all part of performing a rigorous, well-controlled trial. People have probably heard of this RCT or randomized controlled trials. So you really need that randomization in order to account for differences that might occur between the groups, or factors that we might know about, or even ones that we can't know about, so that we don't, that those don't affect the outcome. And it's important for this sort of statistical evaluation that those groups are selected randomly. And then just to talk about blinding a little bit, I mean, blinding, you'll often hear this term double blind, and that means that the person, the participant in the trial, is not aware of what agent they're on, and the evaluators, the treating physician or any of the nurses or any of the technicians, nobody knows whether you're on the active part,
right,
of the
trial
or not. And that's because individual participant knows, then those preconceived ideas about the sort of expectations about the treatment can interfere with the outcome of the trial, and those biases can be introduced by participants, they can be introduced by the treating physicians or technicians. And so it's really important that nobody knows who's getting what.
I think is so cool too is that in the world of relapsing remitting MS, now that we actually have this wide scope of treatments, that it is clinically unethical to have any of them on a placebo.
That's exactly right, Kate. So because we now have 14 disease modifying treatments for relapsing MS, and soon to be a couple more, probably before the end of the year, for at least the last 5 years, in locations and countries where those drugs are commonly available, it is unethical to perform a clinical trial with a placebo control in relapsing remitting MS, which it also makes sense, right? We don't want to spend a lot of money and energy on agents that aren't better than the ones we have already. That doesn't make a lot of sense. And also for the ethics, it doesn't make sense, or it's really unethical to withhold treatment from a person. So the relapsing remitting trials now are all comparator trials. It's comparing, for example, we may talk about this ocrelizumab, this new agent, and in the relapsing remitting trial was compared to Rebif. So for relapsing trials, there are no more placebo-controlled trials, and there are comparative trials. For progressive MS, whether it's secondary progressive or primary progressive, because there really aren't any available treatments, it's still ethical and makes sense to do placebo-controlled trials. And so the primary progressive trials or secondary progressive trials continue to be placebo-controlled. But we're going to have in the near future agents for primary progressive MS and probably for secondary progressive MS. And I'd say if we had this conversation, Kate, a few years from now, we might be talking about the lack of placebo-controlled trials and progressive MS studies as well. So
that's really cool. So for those of you guys watching, Bruce and I are going to go and do a deep dive into clinicaltrials.gov, not at this moment. We want to know if any of you are really looking to find a clinical trial for yourself. At the bottom of your window, if you are viewing this, you have a button that says chat. If you click that button, and if you are a profile and you want to list who you are and what kind of MS you have, we will try and find you a clinical trial during this webcast. So see if you can find that chat icon if you would like us to actually use your case as an example. In the interim, I know that one of the things you mentioned earlier, Bruce, is the idea that clinical trials aren't always about the medicine themselves, and that they are about other elements of MS, such as diet or physical therapy. With us, we have Kathleen Greenberg, who is another My Counterpain user. Kathleen, you've been very patient. Yes, hi. There she is. And I wanted to get kind of a perspective from you of what it's like to, what it's been like for you to be in a trial that wasn't necessarily drug related and what you've learned.
Hi, thank you. I have actually been in several physical therapy trials, one of which was a 12-week, three times a week exercise trial that worked specifically on specific muscle groups, primarily hip flexors, and it was a gait and a motion training trial that they were trying to evaluate how quickly your speed would increase and how your gait would improve. That's a big commitment, you know, like Mitch said, it's a big commitment to go three times a week to Columbia, Maryland for 12 weeks, but it was great, and it was great because it was very collegial. There were four other people working at the same time that I was working in this exercise room. We became very close friends. And it also was something very active that a person could do about their MS that wasn't medical, that didn't require any type of medical intervention, but it was really something physical that you could do on your own, as well as take it home and work on those exercises at home. So it felt very independent. Yeah. And it also, frankly, was free physical therapy for 12 weeks, which is right. Only
which is totally fair, by the way.
Totally right. but you all, there also is a way you can contribute on a very small scale. And going back to that same institution, Kennedy Krieger, I went on a trial that was a two-visit trial. You got a dynamometer to wear for a two-week period. And then you went back and they measured your activity level and how you sleep. But again, it was a contribution for the principal investigators. So I just encourage people to try and take things into their own hands. And that's really something that you can do if you find something that logistically you can attend and that you feel like you physically are capable of doing.
Mitch, can you add on to that? Because I feel like in light of what you did, which was a major pain in the ass, right? It wasn't all about the drugs. Can you talk about that?
Yeah. You know, it gave me a good feeling to know that I was doing something to fight the disease. You know, I'd sat there for a year with no treatments and no hope of getting better. And so there's a certain psychological medicine that you give yourself when you're fighting the disease. But on top of that, then you think in a clinical trial, I'm also contributing to science, and so I'm helping others. So when you're active, not only for your own benefit, but for the benefit of science and others, it's a psychological boost, and I don't know if that's something you could measure, but it's definitely a part of both the placebo group and the treatment group. So I definitely benefit in that way.
Absolutely true. So thank you for that. Bruce, so I'm looking on the side. There's another Kathleen who has listed herself with some stats. Why don't we now move on to you sharing the screen. Bruce is going to take everybody to clinicaltrials.gov. He has made it clear that this is a great way to find a clinical trial. And Bruce, I want to take Kathleen's case. And once you get there and kind of give us the brief tour, we can hammer down on our details and let's see what we can find her in real time.
Okay. So are you, we're all set. You can see the screen?
Yep.
I'd hate to do all of this and be in the dark. Have you all be in the dark. All right. So this is clinicaltrials.gov. So every clinical trial that will potentially be used to generate data for the FDA has to be registered on this website. There can't be trials, some of the phase one trials or maybe academic trials that might not eventually lead to FDA approval don't have to be registered here. But if you want to publish your study, if you want to use it for data, for registration to the FDA, it has to be registered on this website at clinicaltrials.gov. And so this is what it looks like. And I'm gonna walk you through it a little bit. It's kind of like a lot of websites you see. It's not quite as user-friendly as—
Wait, let's be clear. A lot of governmental websites. Yes, there's a whole other webcast about UI, UX, and governments. But we won't even go there today.
Fair enough. So, but here's a little search box. And we could type in multiple sclerosis, and it'll search, and that's— it gives us, almost 1,700 studies.
Wow.
So now that's everything that's out there. You'll see a study here at the beginning that says not yet recruiting, and one that's recruiting, and one that's completed. So this is the kind of first pass. We want to modify the search, so I'm going to click on the little box that says modify this search. And there's a lot of things now, and this gets even, that's not super user-friendly either, but we'll walk through this. So
why don't we start with the top bar, which is fairly general for everybody, and then we will dive into Kathleen.
Yeah, so we have searched, we've used the term just multiple sclerosis. You could put relapsing remitting multiple sclerosis here. You could put progressive multiple sclerosis here if you want to. You could put anything there that you want to. The next box here, which is an important one, Kate, before we kind of get into anything specific, is the status of those trials. So there's a lot of different status. We want to be focused on those studies that are open, that are actually active and open, or ones that are done. And I think for the purpose of today's conversation—
Why would you want to get involved with a closed study?
Well, it's not so much about getting involved, but it's about in some cases, and this is a growing movement, data from some of these trials are eventually supposed to be publicly available. And so there may be, for some of these that are finished, data here that you could look at. But generally, you're going to be interested in open studies. And I think, again, for the purposes of this exercise, we want to look at studies that are currently recruiting. If you're trying to find a trial to participate in, you're going to want ones that are actively recruiting. And so I'm going to click on that for the moment, Kate, that we're looking at all the MS studies, and we're looking at the ones that are actually recruiting participants at the moment.
And I'll even give you two more little nuggets to type in about Kathleen. Yeah. So she has secondary progressive MS, and she's 60 years old.
So let's just do progressive here, because I'm not sure we want to differentiate secondary or primary at this point. And 60. And I don't know if we— every study, I think, has both genders. But let's do that for the moment, and then let's click search and see what we get. So now we have 58 studies that are recruiting that would allow participants 60, probably. Generally, the cutoff is 65 or so, and that are recruiting female participants. So there are your options there.
I'm going to give you another wonderful nugget, which is she lives in Arizona.
All right, so we could go back. And we could go to state, and we could go to Arizona, and let's see what we got.
I'm very hopeful right now.
Yeah. So there are two studies that have a site in Arizona that are enrolling people with progressive MS that are actively recruiting.
So one of the things that Kathleen has also mentioned is that your disability scale is at a 6.5 to a 7.
All right. So I don't think you can search for that, but you can look. And oftentimes, so this is— I've just clicked to the, more information about the study. And you can look here, you can find some things. So this actually, we didn't talk about this on the phone, but this is a phase 4. This is a— we all know that, what's teriflunomide? I'm trying to remember the trade name for that. That's Aubagio, I believe.
Okay.
And that's a marketed drug, right? It's approved and it's marketed and people are taking it. And this is a post-marketing study. So this is a study to understand some aspects of this agent after it's already been approved.
Okay.
It looks like it's, so you can see it's a phase four. Let's see the outcome measure. They're looking to enroll 70 people. It started in October 2013. It's estimated to be done in March. You can see that it's teriflunomide, Aubagio. I got that right, thankfully. There's so many with 14 and a few more on the way. It's hard to always keep track.
I know, right?
I live up to my reputation, Kate, of being the know-all here.
So I don't know. We would have had to put this in post-production if we put that up. Thank you.
So that was good that I got that right. So here you go. Here's the eligibility, 21 to 60. So, boy, we just make it there. And then it says here, EDSS, look down here, 1 to 6 inclusive. Okay. So it looks like Kathleen would qualify based on her age and the type of MS she has and her disability status.
But she's a 6.5, so that might actually be a deal breaker for her.
Well, and so I think, yeah, and that may be, up to the discretion of the study. I mean, I think EDSS is a bit subjective, but the difference between a 6 and a 6.5 can be subtle and be different in the eye of the evaluator. So I personally wouldn't let that stop me from,
and if
this trial looked interesting to me and something I wanted to participate in, I probably wouldn't let that stop me from exploring this further.
Can we take a look at the other one just for kicks? I know she had two options.
So this one is, again, this is not a drug study.
Okay.
Exploring the effectiveness of sensor-based training, balance training on outcome measures. So that's interesting. This is an academic. See, it's taking place in University of Arizona. That's in Tucson. And this is not a drug trial. It's looking at
virtual reality and improving lower extremity.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. The intervention is an Exer game. That sounds pretty interesting. It's home-based, so that might be a little bit easier than having to, I mean, you still have to go visit the evaluations are probably still done in the clinic, but the intervention's done at home, which we see more and more of those kinds of studies. Let's see what kind of things we can learn here. They're looking to recruit 200 people. You can see things here about the intervention. Let's see what else we can. So this is not a trial that's specifically for MS. You see, it's recruiting people with a number of different diseases that might affect balance. And so I don't see an EDSS cut off here, but I think because it's about balance. And balance training, it would need to probably be somebody who is ambulatory, right? And so that would be, I think, one of the criteria that someone would need to be walking at least. And whether they could walk with an assisted device or not, that would be something you'd have to explore with them. And then so that actually brings up a good point, Kate, is that normally here there's a contact person.
Mm-hmm.
Towards the bottom, contacts and locations. So here's the contact for the principal investigator. I heard Kathleen talk about, she used the principal investigator term. I'm glad we defined that. So there's the person, that's the person's email. So you can email them. There's a phone number. And so that would be your opportunity to reach out and ask some questions.
I want to ask people that are watching, if anyone has any questions of what Bruce is talking about right now, it'd be great if you put them on the chat bar. Bruce, I want you to go back to the beginning, kind of the homepage, because I do know in that top section, there are a couple more qualifiers that are a little bit confusing. I remember if you go to multiple sclerosis, I just want to be sure. Obviously an open study, and I think there was one more term. Let me just make sure the recruitment. Okay, open, good.
Yeah.
And then what type of study?
That's an excellent point, Kate, also. So the study type, I think mostly what people would be going to be interested in are interventional studies.
Okay, so I think that's really important for people to
know. Yeah, right. So it's a good point. So these are studies that are actually testing something versus observational, which is more of just watching a cohort or group of people living with whatever the condition might be, observing them without an intervention. And that those are important and interesting as well. But interventional, I think, are what most people are interested in. That's actually testing an agent or some type of intervention. Could be rehabilitation, could be diet, could be a supplement, or it could be a drug.
Yep.
And then also what was interesting, Kate, is you can pick down here what phase, right? So remember we said generally for an interventional trial in MS, we're really going to be starting at phase two, right? That's actually testing an agent in a person that's living with the condition. Phase three are those big studies with thousands of people, participants. And then I think it would be also prudent and interesting to click on phase four here. I mean, these are four drugs that are already approved, but what we need to learn more about how they're working out in the real world. It could give you access to a treatment that you might not otherwise have access to. It could give you access to care and a level of care that perhaps for whatever reason you don't have access to. You could click on phase four as well in that category.
Go ahead.
No, and so I just think those are other things to keep in mind.
Well, we've certainly talked about all the positives that have come in getting involved with these clinical researchers and, with these studies. And, I kind of want to just have a moment of touching on the negative. And Mitch, I'll throw this to you now. Going back to the Rituxan trial, there were some amazing positives in terms of feeling better, but there turned out to be a negative too. So tell us a little bit about that.
Sure. So the end game is where it got complicated for me in that trial. I had great success with the drug, and for 2 years, I'm essentially in remission. And so I want more of the drug. But from the trial perspective, the trial is coming to an end. And there is not necessarily a plan going forward. So I tried to communicate with the trial administrators, which is difficult. I went through my trial doctor and asked if there would be what's called an open label phase. Sometimes if a trial is showing success, they'll just continue the trial and probably take everybody off placebo and have everybody go ahead and do the trial drug and see what they can learn more about it. When I asked that question, they said, maybe, but it's probably going to be a year or so before we decide. So that's, so that's telling me
a
I'm
year
not
too long.
A year is a long time in PPMS world. So then plan B was to go to my insurance company and say, I did well on this drug. I've got proof that it worked for me. I need you to cover, out of trial infusions for me. But what that required from the insurance company was a letter from the trial folks saying that I was indeed on the trial drug and not the placebo. And when I asked for that, I was told that the study is still blinded. It's going to take 18 months before we can get that answer. So, the bureaucracy, the red tape involved in the end of a clinical trial left a pretty bad taste in my mouth. I ended up getting a lot of infusions. I got six more infusions through the insurance company, but they were delayed and the insurance company fought me. That's a whole other
webinar. We'll do another webcast about that one.
Yeah. And so I did get a lot of infusions outside the trial, but eventually, because I couldn't stay on a good schedule, it stopped working and I got out of the business. But it's, I don't say this because I'm trying to discourage people from clinical trials, but just realize that there are some complications like this, red tape complications that can come into play.
Like you don't even think about the fact that you might have this amazing result, but you're beholden to the provider, right? On some level, and that's hard. Bruce, for you, in the realm of taking a risk to be part of science, can you talk about also the dangers in terms of health, if there are any that are prevalent?
Sorry, Kate, the dangers, sorry?
For your health.
Well, so, these are investigational drugs or interventions. And we talked about a lot, there's a lot of work that is accomplished before it gets to a clinical trial to establish safety. So there are criteria and rules and regulations about all the kinds of tests you have to do before you actually put something in a human that mitigate that risk as much as you possibly can before it goes into a person. And then we talked about phase one, where you're injecting the agent in a healthy individual and you're monitoring them thoroughly for any side effects and trying to get a sense for what the risks might be. It's very thorough by the time it gets to a person. And by the time you're in a phase two study, you're feeling pretty confident that at least the short-term risks are well known, and the side effects are well known. But it's investigational. You're a guinea pig here, really. And I mean, in a sense. So there is a risk, and there have been not so much in MS, but there have been trials where people have been injured as a consequence of participating. In MS, the one example I can think of, and maybe your viewers will remember the trials with Tysabri, and actually during the course of the clinical program, those years in clinical trials, there weren't any serious concerns, but it was after the studies completed in this phase four stage that we talked about, in this post-marketing stage, where some of the participants in those clinical trials developed this PML, the progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, and I dare you to say that three times
fast. I can't. I have to.
So PML is a lot easier. So that, and I believe one or more of those three participants died as a consequence of that. And of course, we've gotten a lot better at predicting who's going to develop PML, and there's a whole program now for mitigating that risk. And it's a fine agent for some people with MS, but the risks are pretty low, I think, because of all of the work that goes in ahead of time to establish the safety. But you really do never know for sure until you put it in a person. And then, of course, you can do everything you can in the setting of a clinical trial to establish the safety and effectiveness of a agent. Until it gets out into the real world, until it gets into the hands of neurologists and gets used out in a real world setting for a period of time, you won't completely sort of have a definition of what the safety and effectiveness is. And that's why those post-marketing studies are so important.
Right.
The FDA has monitoring and surveillance of in the whole country on drugs. And so you'll see occasionally sometimes these notices from the FDA about a safety issue with a medication after it's marketed. So I think we do everything we can to try to get the agent, the FDA and everybody involved in this, to mitigate those safety concerns before a drug gets out to the public. And there's a tremendous amount of monitoring once it gets out there. And so it's balancing kind of that urgency to get treatments to people in as expeditious way as possible, but also doing it in a safe way. And it's finding that balance, I think, that we're continually trying to improve.
Awesome. So we are pretty much out of time, but before we formally close, I would love to, for both of you, to kind of wrap the show talking about the biggest takeaways. So I'll start with you, Bruce. What do you think are the most important things for people to be taken away from these 45 minutes about clinical trials and their living with MS?
I think, Kate, the one thing I'd like people to take away is that we are going, no matter whether a trial is successful, whether the agent ultimately is approved and is accessible for people living with MS, or it fails and it shows that it doesn't work, no matter what the outcome is, we learn something from clinical trials. We invest a lot of resources and time in identifying targets and ideas for therapies in preclinical work in the laboratory, perhaps in animals and so forth. But there's nothing like studying MS, actually the disease itself. And so we learn so much from clinical trials, whether they are successful or whether they're not successful,
your path.
Yeah, and so that's what I would leave people with is it's disappointing when a trial doesn't work, but we learn something no matter what happens. And if it's done in a rigorous, controlled, blinded, all of those things we talked about, if it's done that way, we're going to learn something about a trial no matter whether it works or not.
Mitch, anything else you want to close with?
Yeah, I've got this analogy I've thought of is people remember when Winston Churchill said, democracy is the worst form of government, except all those other forms that have been tried from time to time. So I feel the same way about clinical trials. Placebo-controlled clinical trials can drive you crazy, but it's the best form of science that we have right now for ensuring safe, effective treatments in patients. Something better will come along one day, but for now, you know, I encourage people to participate. Go in with your eyes open. Realize there may be some disappointments, but this is the best way to move forward.
And the fact that we actually, in our lifetimes, have all gotten to see pretty amazing progress.
Right.
And so, Mitch, I really want to thank you for being here with me. And Bruce, I can't help it. Behind you, I keep thinking that you have these beautiful colored pictures of MRI scans. Are they, or are they just art?
No, they are MRI scans. They're diffusion tensor images. And I'm really a science geek. I just don't pretend to be one, so.
That's awesome. Well, we really appreciate both of you and everyone who has been on this webcast. Thank you so much for participating. We will be sending this out to the world to give more knowledge to people living with MS on how they can improve their lives and empower themselves to be better and to feel better. Kate Milliken checking out, and we'll see you guys next time. Thanks, everybody.
Bye.